Father, thank you for your grace to us. Thank you for your provision in Christ. Thank you for your word, which we can trust and rely on, even in these places such as we're looking at, where we see people acting foolishly and wrongly rather than righteously and godly. Help us to be instructed by their failures, so that we don't make similar ones in our own lives. So we entrust our time tonight to you. Pray that you would make it profitable. In Christ's name, amen. I'm only slightly on Facebook. What I mean by that is I don't have any profile, and the only reason I did it was that when we made a trip to Taiwan and Malaysia, Facebook Messenger was a good way of interacting. So I only rarely get anything from it, and it's always from a family member. So there was a notification in email this morning, and so I clicked on it, and it was something my daughter in Phoenix had commented on. And so I clicked on, and there was a shirt there, and it was with Israel and so forth. Somebody had just made a trip there. So I thought, oh, that's interesting, I wonder. And then there was some coins on the front of it, and said, can you understand this puzzle? And I didn't have the slightest clue what the puzzle was or what was involved in it. And Heather made some comment that, oh, I haven't seen that for a long time, which made me even more. She understood this, and I didn't have a remote clue what it was all about. And to make a long story short, it was something I wouldn't have guessed if I'd sat there for 3 years. But years ago, somebody preached a sermon somewhat related to the passage we're going to look at tonight, called 10 Pennies in a Shirt, or 10 Shekels in a Shirt. And I guess it's a fairly popular sermon. It bears no resemblance to what the text is about, but nevertheless, so I went and read through a transcript of it and so forth. And so, you know, when you come to a passage like where we are, Judges chapter 17 and 18, next week especially, and you think, how ever can I preach this in public? Well, this one is a little easier tonight, but 10 shekels and a shirt. We'll be reading about that in a little bit, and you ask me how you'd preach on that. But
does this have an end? Like the story, is this
that was the story. 10 shekels and a shirt is a sermon that this person preached about, and apparently it's one of the great sermons, from what I've read, of the 20th century, about which I'd heard nothing. Preached by, Carol Ann will appreciate this, a Christian Missionary Alliance pastor. So, must be heavenly in terms of. So the book of Judges has this prologue, and we've looked at that. And the prologue, as you remember, was mainly about, first of all, Israel taking possession of the land when they got into the promised land. But then there was the note of most of them, it said they didn't drive out the foreigners, they lived among them, and so forth. And then it goes in the second chapter to describe this continuing pattern that we've talked about, this spiral. And we've seen the spiral play out through the six judges, that you have departure from God, you have God's judgment in terms of bringing in oppression, you have this cry of pain, and God in his grace sends a deliverer, but then the people have rest for a time, and then they go back into apostasy, and it carries down until we get to the end of Samson's life, and we wonder, wherever is it going to go from here? Well, the story ends in terms of the chronology at that particular point. So what happens in chapter 17 doesn't follow chapter 16 in terms of when it happened. And there are two stories. One is chapter 17 and 18. Those are all connected. And then there's another, the three chapters, chapters 19, 20, and 21, which we'll look at next week. And they are kind of portraits of where the nation is at this particular time as we're about to move into the period of 1 Samuel. And the first stories are what you would talk about as religious confusion and religious corruption. Then we're going to get to chapter 19 to 21, and it's moral corruption on a very high level. And the nation is, unless God intervenes in some remarkable way, going down the tubes. And as you would expect, now thinking through the history, as you would expect, God begins his point of deliverance. And you think of how connected to the gospel this is, in the most unexpected and unusual way. So think of where the book of 1 Samuel begins. With who? A barren woman longing for children and unable to have children. And the story of God's deliverance is that he is going to start in the most unlikely of places. As you remember, that's where the story of Genesis begins. It begins with a couple who are in their 90s and still haven't had their first child. And God intervenes in that way. And then we come to the New Testament. Where do you begin in the New Testament? With a barren woman in Luke, unable to have a child. And then God uses Elizabeth to be the one to, as it were, have the experience that Mary is going to follow up and confirm that experience. So there's this fascinating way in which God works in history. But we're tracking Israel at this particular point. So let's look to chapter 17. And the story we're going to look at comes in three parts. First of all, there's the story of Micah, and then the story of Micah and the Levite, and then the story of the tribe of Dan in chapter 18. Now, the tribe of Dan has been in our vision related to what? Who was from Dan? Somebody with long hair until he lost it.
Samson.
So, Samson is from Dan. So, chapter 17 and verse 1. We'll read the first six verses. There was a man of the hill country of Ephraim whose name was Micah. And he said to his mother, "The 1,100 pieces of silver that were taken from you, about which you uttered a curse and also spoke it in my ears, behold, the silver's with me. I took it." And his mother said, "Blessed be my son by the Lord." And he restored the 1,100 pieces of silver to his mother. And his mother said, "I dedicate the silver to the Lord, to Yahweh, from my hand, from my son, to make a carved image and a metal image. Now, therefore, I will restore it to you." So when he restored the money to his mother took 200 pieces of silver and gave it to the silversmith, who made it into a carved image and a metal image. And it was in the house of Micah. And the man Micah had a shrine, and he made an ephod and household gods, and ordained one of his sons, who became his priest. And the editor, writer, can't bear it any longer, and he writes, "In those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes." Yeah. So let's just track this. We're introduced to a man named Micah. We shouldn't miss that, because his name is a significant name. Micah means, "Who is like the Lord?" Me who is like Yah of Yahweh. So it's me kia, and or Mikayahu. So he has a name unlike Samson. Remember, Samson's parents gave him a name, Samson, son, a pagan name. This man has a Yahweh, a God-honoring name. But, and we'll see it as we go through, you'll hear the name of God used, but the name of God is used to get involved in the most ungodly of behaviors. So there's a veneer of Yahweh over all of that's going to happen. But that's where Israel is. They are Yahweh people. But it's like a, you know, a piece of imitation wood that has this little veneer on the top, and underneath it's all sawdust, all glued together and kept together. That's where the nation is. Now, they live in the hill country of Ephraim. So this is to the center of the country, a little bit north of where Dan is. Dan was in the valley of Jezreel. This is sort of in the center, the heart of where the country is. We've met Ephraim before in the book. Can you remember in what context we met Ephraim? Remember, Ephraim was angry at Gideon because he didn't call them to help in the battle, and they're ready to fight Gideon, and he has to talk them down. And then they made the mistake of taking on Ehud, and they complained that Ehud didn't call them. And they thought Ehud was like Gideon. Ehud's not like Gideon. And they had...
Jephthah. Not Ehud.
You're right. Jephthah is right. Thank you very much, Connor. So Jephthah, they get killed trying to get back into their country. You remember the whole Shibboleth kind of story at that particular point. So the story begins in this weird way of him having 1,100 shekels. That's a lot of money. Remember how much each of the... leaders of the Philistines offered to Delilah if she would betray 1,100 for each one, 5,500 in all. So this is a lot of money. This is a well-to-do family in this particular occasion. And somebody steals 1,100 shekels from her, and she curses that person and says words that put a curse on him in the hearing of her son. Now, her son is an adult. We know that because he appointed one of his own sons a priest. So his son must have been, you know, 20 or so at least, somewhere in that range. So Mike is a man in his, let's say, 40s. This mother's in her 70s or 80s. I mean, she's remarkably old for the culture of that particular time. And she issues this curse, and Micah is terrified enough about it to confess, I stole the money, and I'll give it back, because she doesn't respect his mother, but he does respect her curse and feels this curse coming upon her. And when she receives it, she says, bless you, my son, which is a very strange response. But almost certainly what she's doing is trying to counter the curse. So the blessing is meant to balance the curse. Now let me back away from this just for a minute, because I was trying to think my way into this. And the whole issue of curses has become a big thing, especially in the charismatic community. And the whole idea of discovering curses that are placed on you and having people that will remove the curse, and generational curses, finding the curse that is placed on you and having somebody who can pray the curse away. And I want to tell you that most of that is utterly unbiblical superstition. There are curses that are placed in the Bible on people, and it is either by God directly or by a prophet or Moses or Joshua or one of his spokesmen. But there's no indication that an individual can put a curse on me. And it's an interesting verse. How does Jesus say we should respond to someone who curses us? We should bless them. Bless the one who curses you, and pray for the one who opposes you. So rather than fearing their curse, I'm interested in the Lord's command, is we should pray for the curser, not for ourselves under the curse, as if they have anything to do it. Because the only curse that needs to be feared is the curse of God himself that comes upon us. And we can put ourselves under God's judgment because of our sin. Paul makes that clear. He says, if anyone preaches Christ or another gospel, let him be accursed. So there can be a divine judgment that comes upon us, but it's not something that happens accidentally or because, anyway. So she says, I bless you. And she says, hey, you bring back the money and I'll give you money so we can, or you can have a god made for us to worship, or an idol to worship. And then that is all carried out in what follows. He restored the 1,100 pieces of silver. My mother said, I dedicate the silver to Yahweh from my hand, which sounds great if she'd stopped there. But when she keeps going, she moves from something positive to something that is utterly horrific in terms of biblical life. I dedicate the silver to Yahweh from my hand for my son to make a carved image and a metal image. And all you can think of is, that's the second commandment. And you're just throwing this. You're saying that you're dedicating it to the Lord for do something that the Lord has expressly forbidden. And then, intriguingly, he gives back the 1,100 pieces of silver. And it says she took 200 pieces and gave it to the silversmith. And you sort of, well, what? I thought it was the whole 1,100 that was supposed to go to the Lord. I thought that's what you dedicated. But it turns out that with her fingers crossed behind her back, she only meant part of that. And it's 200. And some silversmith comes back and with this little idol and a metal idol, the image, a carved image and a metal image, probably a wooden thing covered with silver in this particular way. And it's in the house of Micah. And he says, well, since I've got this, I might as well go all the way. So he now erects a shrine. And there is an altar of some kind, and there is other religious paraphernalia, and he takes one of his own sons and he ordains him as a priest. So now he's got his religious shrine, homemade, man-made, in defiance of God. What his mother could have done was, of course, send the money to the tabernacle if she wanted to dedicate it to God, give it to the priests at Shiloh, which was where, as we'll see in chapter 18, verse 31, where the tabernacle is at this particular time, but she doesn't. So now Micah has his own pagan altar in direct contrast to what God said, only it's a Yahweh altar. This isn't Baal, this isn't Dagon, this is Yahweh is being served. So now you can see that's part one. Homemade religion. I've made my own religion. I've got my own way to worship. I'm doing all of these kind of things. And the writer of Judges sets back and says, there was no king in Israel. Actually, he'll repeat that four times. Here, chapter 17, verse 6, chapter 18, verse 1, that's how we'll begin the next chapter, chapter 19, verse 1, and then the very last verse in the book, there was no king in Israel. It may be the case, we can't be sure, that that gives us a clue to when the book was written. That it was written early in the, or sometime in the kingship of, I would think, David. Around that particular period of time. Because one of the things we're going to discover as we read through the rest of Israel's history is the kings of Israel didn't prevent idolatry. As a matter of fact, many of them sponsored it, and it began with David's own son, Solomon. It's hard to imagine how you could write, there was no king in Israel, that's why you had all of this going on, after Solomon had come along and done what he had done in that particular time. So there was idol temples all over the hill country around Jerusalem, built for his wives to worship their various gods. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And we've talked about this before. That's Samson. Samson saw her, she looked right in his own eyes, wanted her. So that led him into sin. Now it's led this into sin. And I think I commented, the striking thing about this text is not that it says everyone did what was wrong, what they knew was wrong in their hearts. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And they defined right. This is very much like Eve. Remember in the original thing? I saw that it was good for food. It was right in her own eyes, despite the commands of God. And it is amazing how many ways you can rationalize doing wrong and convincing yourself that it's really right. So that's the end of the first part of this story. Any observations, any things that we should observe or notice in these first six verses? Okay. You can go and sit down again, Martin. Okay, Jordan is...
I don't know if there's much of an answer to this, but the response of Micah's mother to the return of those 1,100 shekels of silver, it seems like there's such a discongruity in what she's saying. I solemnly consecrate my silver to the Lord for my son to make an image. Are they just at this point really unfamiliar with the law? Has it been forgotten for a while? Because she doesn't seem to blink an eye, you know. I consecrate this silver to Yahweh to make an idol. Does she understand the inherent contradiction in what she's saying, or have they been... at this point, very far removed from any good religious teaching? They haven't heard a word from the Lord, maybe, and they don't even know right from wrong in this regard.
It's always hard to read that. I think the nation has been so thoroughly Canaanized that this just seems appropriate. I mean, they've bought into Canaanite religion. They just have relabeled it on mm-hmm. that particular way. And this seems like a natural thing for her to do. And it's because, I can't even think of what passage of scripture talks about, but I'm thinking there's a place in the Old Testament where it says, and a word from God was rare in those days, mm-hmm. meaning they weren't, I think it's early in Samuel, isn't it? Which would fit in terms of the time that there'd been this deviation. So by the time we get to Samuel, we see Eli's sons committing sexual immorality with the women who were serving at the tabernacle and thinking that was in some way normal.
It may be the case where their thinking is, well, this is how you worship a god.
And the reason that they're doing it is because by having their own God, they can manipulate or get what they want. They can get a blessing by doing this. I mean, the rest of the story is just going to play out. It's utter spiritual idiocy. And it's only going to get, by the end of the story, they're going to be willing to kill for that, for those gods. So
it's really, really syncretistic.
It is.
I mean...
But, I mean, sadly, without going into, you know, too much church history, you think about the kind of superstition that has crept through the historic church down through the years, that you end up looking at and think, how did you ever get to that from reading the New Testament? How do you ever put that together? And the Reformation was in... You know, that's 500 years ago, but that was an answer to the most appalling kinds of things. But we're surrounded with it right now. I think I mentioned this story here before. It's back in the news again. this kerfuffle going on in the United Church of Canada because a woman who's an outspoken atheist doesn't believe anything Christian is a pastor of a United Church. And the whole suggestion is that to remove her would be against the United Church's desire for diversity. And how do any sane people come to the place to think? And how can she think as a sane person? I should be expected to be supported by a church when I don't believe a single thing it purports to believe in, sadly, like liberal churches down here. They don't believe in most of that stuff, but or the gospel is what I shouldn't call it that stuff. So it's going to get worse. Hang in. It'll get worse. And the story at the end is shocking. I mean, this is one of the ones where the kicker is at the very end of the story. So next we meet another one. He's introduced to us as a young man of Bethlehem in Judah, of the family of Judah, who was a Levite. Now, I'm not quite sure how we put those two things together, because if he's a Levite, he can't be from the family of Judah in a physical way, although there may have been some intermarriage, but in some way he is still considered a Levite. And as we'll see, he is very much a Levite in that particular way. And he happens to have lived sojourned, which means he was a temporary resident in Bethlehem. Now, this is Bethlehem's going to come up in the next story as well. And then we're going to get the book of Ruth. So Bethlehem comes to the fore. And it says, and the man departed from the town of Bethlehem in Judah to sojourn where he could find a place. You need to understand, the tribe of Levi was not given an inheritance. There was 48 cities that were set out for the Levites, but they didn't have an ancestral home like others did. So in some sense, they weren't rooted to a particular tribe and place like the others were. And they would go up to Jerusalem, but they would also live in some of their various towns. So this is a footloose and fancy-free Levite. As it turns out, he's from the priestly tribe, so he's not just an ordinary Levite, and he's young. Now, a Levite began to serve, as the priests began to serve when they were 30. So he's not serving as a priest at this stage. He's younger than that. So he wanders around and he just happens, it says, as he journeyed, he came to the hill country of Ephraim, to the house of Micah. Now we're going to find out earlier, he's wandered around in a few other places too. And he just happens there, and he bumps into Micah. And when Micah meets him, he thinks, what an opportunity. This is great. Actually, he first of all has to ask him these questions. Micah said, where do you come from? And he said, I'm a Levite of Bethlehem in Judah, and I'm going to sojourn where I find a place. I'm looking for a place to hang out and to find roots. And Micah immediately says, stay with me and be to me a father. Now that's used because obviously he's much younger, this Levite, but be to me a father in the sense of a spiritual leader, spiritual figure in this case, and priest, and I'll give you, here we are, 10 pieces of silver a year and a suit of clothes, and you're living. So I'll give you 10 shekels, suit of clothes, and I'll pay for your expenses. You've got a job if you want it. Because Micah thinks, I can validate this. My son is really, that's pretty, off base. I know enough to know he's not really a legitimate priest. But if I can have a Levitical priest, we can really make this church grow. And we can make a moving thing out of this. And the young man, who at that particular point, if he was at all theological or biblical or honoring God, would say, That is a horrible idea. And you need to get rid of the idols and smash them and honor God and get your life squared away. But no, he says, man, this is what I've been looking for, a church of my own to pastor. Well, not quite that language, but, and the Levite went in, and the Levite was content to dwell with this man, and the young man became to him like one of his sons, and Micah ordained the Levite. Wow. So they have their own little service, and again, total contradiction, Jordan, to anything that is supposed to take place. And the young man became his priest and was in the house of Micah. So now he has a man-made religion, and a man-made God, and a man-made shrine served by a man-made priest. And then Micah said, now I know Yahweh will prosper me because I have a Levite as priest. I'm not a big fan, but I've watched occasionally, and I'm always struck when I see those scenes in The Godfather where they're plotting and carrying out. And you remember how so many of them go, there's a baptism and the family's gathered around the baptistry and there's the music and all of this very religious Catholic ceremony going on. And then it'll be intercut with the murders and the slaughters and the brutal things that are going on. And that happens a number of times in the movie, this interplay of the religious facade and the expression of all the right things and the enormous respect both that they give to the clergy and the clergy give to them, undoubtedly because they're getting paid well to do it. And on the other hand, the abysmal life that they are living and practicing. And there's something of, as long as I keep in touch with doing these kind of things, then the Lord will bless me. So I'll do my religious stuff, and at the same time, I'll do my thing in my own way, and I'm putting the Lord in my debt. It's not as far-fetched, although the forms that it takes are very different from this. And all is going well, and Micah's got his little church going, and things are doing well, and it's apparently known. And then, all of a sudden, events elsewhere change the whole thing. So now we go into chapter 18. And there's three movements in this. So let me just read verse 1. It says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. So again, that kind of reminder, you know, this is anarchy, this is chaos. And in those days, the tribe of the people of Dan was seeking for itself an inheritance to live in. For until then, no inheritance among the tribes of Israel had fallen to them. Now they had been given an inheritance. That is a piece of land that they were supposed to conquer. And chapter 1, verse 34 says, the Amorites pressed the people of Dan back into the hill country, for they did not allow them to come down to the plain. The Amorites persisted in dwelling in Mount Hariz and Ahalon and Shalbeim, but the hand of the house of Joseph rested heavily on them, and they became subject to forced labor. So Dan, of all of them, it says the others, they didn't drive out the inhabitants, but with Dan, they just didn't make any headroads at all. So what we had in the Samson story probably occurs after this, but they've got a problem. They aren't making it in the land that God had given to them. So what should have been their response? Clearly repentance and asking God to help them. But they're going to solve their own problem in their own way. And it's a kind of now parody of what happened to Israel. Because Israel's going to go and take a land, and God commands them to send spies into the land ahead of them. Joshua's going to cross the Jordan, and God says to them to send spies ahead to spy out the land. But this is an entirely self-initiated movement on the tribe of Dan. They're going to solve their own problem in their own particular way. And they have this genius solution to send out five spies. And they're going to find a place for them all to move. To use the real estate phrase, location, location, location. I've got to go faster. So we have it at the beginning of verse 2. So the people of Dan sent five able men from the whole number of their tribe from Zora. Ah, who lived in Zora? Samson. And from Eshtaol to spy out the land and to explore it. And they said to them, go and explore the land. So they head north. And they get on a trail that just happens they came to the hill country of Ephraim, to the house of Micah, and lodged there. So they visit the shrine. Just happened to the Holiday Inn Express by the church that was there. And when they were by the house of Micah, they recognized the voice of the young Levite. Didn't recognize what he looked like, and they weren't expecting to see him at this particular place. And they turned aside and said to him, who brought you here? What are you doing in this place? What's your business here? So he'd wandered around a bit, and he'd wandered through Zora and Eshtaol before, and they'd met him. And he said to them, verse 4, this is how Micah dealt with me. He's hired me. I've become his priest. Sounds good to us. If you're a priest, then let's get a blessing from God on our project of disobedience. That's not quite what they said. And they said to him, inquire of God, please, that we may know whether the journey on which we are setting out will succeed. And the priest said to them, go in peace. The journey on which you go is under the eye of the Lord. Now that's a typical false prophecy. Do you notice? The journey you're going on is under the eye of the Lord. They take it that that's positive. But if they came back and said it all went to pieces, well, all I told you was it was under the eye of the Lord. He was watching it. He did watch you. So false prophets always have this way of saying something that can be interpreted in 14 different ways, depending on how you would like it to turn out at the end. Then the five men departed and came to Laish. Now Laish is way to the north. It's as far north as you can go into the land of Canaan. It was the place where Abraham and his 318 men chased the people who'd taken Lot captive. Do you remember that story in the book of Genesis? And this is where they finally caught them, up at Laish, way up to the north part of the country, right on the border of Lebanon today. Sidon, as we'll see, will come up in this particular place. It's a beautiful spot. And some of you have been there to see it. They came to Laish and saw the people who were there, how they lived in security after the manner of the Sidonians, the Lebanese, quiet and unsuspecting. But because the Sidon was the major power in the area, that's way over on the coast. This is inland a long way, and it's in hilly country, so it's a very isolated kind of location. Quiet and unsuspecting, lacking nothing that is in the earth. There was abundant water. It's very fertile in terms of the land. It is, I think, one of the prettiest places in all of the country when you're there. It's just, it really is a lovely spot. And you walk this long trail crossing the water that's running under your feet as you go up to where you can still see the part of the shrine where they were later going to do some building. And they were far from the Sidonians and had no dealings with anyone. So they're isolated enough that they're vulnerable and they're easy prey. And when they came back to their brothers at Zora and Eshtaol, so they go all the way back, their brothers said to them, what do you report? They said, arise, let's go up against them. We've seen the land. Behold, it's very good. And will you do nothing? You're just going to stay here? Don't be slow to enter in and possess the land. As soon as you go, you will come to an unsuspecting people. The land is spacious. God has given it into your hands, a place where there is no lack of anything that is on the earth. Interesting how they use God language in the process of disobeying God fully and totally. So a group of them say, we're going to do it. Samson's family was apparently one of the groups that didn't go. They are the left behind group. But this, with at least 600 men and their wives and their children, set out. So verse 11, 600 men of the tribe of Dan, armed with weapons of war, set out with Zorah and Eshtaol. So they go up as a military band, and they went up and encamped at Kiriath Jearim in Judah. On that account, that place is called Mahana Dan. Mahana means camp, so the camp of Dan to this day. Behold, it is west of Kiriath Jearim, and they passed on from there to the hill country of Ephraim and came to the house of Micah. Now, that was not the quickest way, but the five spies have got an idea, and I'm not sure whether they told others or they plan it, but verse 14, the five men who'd gone to scout out the country of Laish said to their brothers, "Do you know that in these houses there's an ephod? Household gods, a carved image, and a metal image? Now therefore, consider what you will do." And their idea is, we can have our own religion up there in our new town. And they turned aside there and came to the house of the young Levite at the home of Micah and asked him about his welfare, asked him how he was. The five recognized him. Now the 600 men of the Danites, armed with their weapons of war, stood by the entrance of the gate. And the five men who'd gone to scout out the land went up, entered, took the carved image, the ephod, the household gods, the metal image, while the priest stood by the entrance of the gate with the 600 men armed with weapons of war. And when these went into Micah's house and took the carved image, the ephod, the house of household gods, and the metal image, the priest said to them, "What are you doing?" And they said, "Keep quiet, put your hand on your mouth and come with us and be to us a father and a priest. Isn't it better for you to be priest in a mega church than, is it better for you to be priest in a little tiny church, priest of one man, or to be priest to a tribe and a clan in Israel?" And the priest's heart was glad. Got his offer to the bigger, better church. I know pastors never think that way. He took the ephod and the household gods and the carved image and went along with the people. So he's got a promotion. Once again, opportunity is knocked, and he seized the opportunity. So they turned and departed, putting the little ones and the livestock and the goods in front of them. Why are they doing that? Normally, you don't put the vulnerable ones out front, unless you're expecting an attack from the rear. So they're expecting Micah to come after them. They're expecting that they're not going to get away with this. When they'd gone a distance from the home of Micah, the men who were in the houses near Micah's house were called out, and they overtook the people of Dan. And they shouted to the people of Dan, who turned around and said to Micah, "What's the matter with you, that you come with such a company?" Which they fully expected. And he said, "You take my gods that I made and the priest and go away. And what have I left? How then do you ask me, what's the matter with me? You stole my gods and I made them." I mean, the absurdity of idolatry. And when you get into the book of Isaiah, some of the great passages in Isaiah are just mocking idol worship. A man goes out into the woods, he cuts down a tree, he parts it in half. With part of it, he starts a fire and he roasts his lunch. And the other part, he carves an idol and he bows down and prays to the thing that he's made. And Micah is just full of scorn for all of that. And you've got the same kind of thing here. And the people of Dan said to him, "Don't let your voice be heard among us, lest angry fellows fall upon you and you lose your life with the lives of your household." In other words, you keep talking, you're going to get killed. And the people of Dan went their way, and when Micah saw they were too strong for him, he returned and went back to his house. But the people of Dan took what Micah had made, and the priest who belonged to him, and they came to Laish. And they're not now carrying out harem, that is, the taking over the land in obedience to God. This is slaughter of unsuspecting people. They came to a people quiet and unsuspecting and struck them with the edge of the sword, and burned the city with fire. And there was no deliverer because it was far from Sidon and they had no dealings with anyone. It is in the valley that belongs to Beth Rehob. And it is still a pretty isolated area. As I said, it's a lovely area, but nevertheless, it is isolated. So then they rebuilt the city and lived in it. Now the gates of this city, and it's a fairly impressive structure that you go in, and it's dated back to about 1800 BC, and it's made of earthen things, mounds built up on one another, and this a fairly impressive gate structure that you can still visit, and it would go back to that time. It's one of those places where you stand and look and think, Abraham saw this, you know, as a human kind of construction. And they named the city Dan. So this is the furthest north part now of Israel. Right around the corner from it, not right around the corner, 5-6 miles away, is Caesarea Philippi. This is the part of the country where the Lord was when he's asked, who do you say that I am? And there was a major pagan worship site there. Now Israel will be described as from Dan in the north to Beersheba in the south. And that's the way. From Dan to Beersheba means the whole length of the land. This is where kind of the settlement of Israel is in those particular days. And actually, even now, there's a you go up on this high hill and you look down and there's a road and there's wire fence. Now it's changed a little bit. When we first went, that was a United Nations patrolled road because on the other side is Lebanon. Well, the Israelis moved in and they pushed it a little bit further. Read of bombings going on to Israel against people who live in that area. This is one of the places that they are after. So they named the city Dan after the name of Dan, their ancestor, who was born to Israel, to Jacob. Dan means judgment, interestingly. And the name of the city was Laish at the first. And here's the sting in the trail, the unexpected ending. And the people of Dan set up the carved image for themselves. And Jonathan, son of Gershom, son of Moses, and his sons were priests to the tribe of the Danites until the day of the captivity of the land. The Hebrew scribes had such trouble with that they stuck another letter in. And actually they raised it, so they don't write it in the normal way. And so it reads in the Hebrew text, if you read it and follow their reading, the son of Manasseh, because they can't bear the thought to say, this is a great, great grandson. Son here means descendant of. This is Moses' family. This is not just any Levite. This isn't some little nobody. This guy's in the line of Moses. And it's just, okay, we're reading about how bad things got. And this is a Levite now who's up on that particular site serving this pagan altar. And they set up Micah's carved image that he made as long as the house of God was at Shiloh. Now, later on, there'll be a civil war. And you remember Solomon's son, Jeroboam, will split away. And for Jeroboam to establish the northern kingdom, he puts up golden calves at two places to worship. One was at Bethel, the other one is at
Dan.
So you go there today and you can see the altar constructed by Jeroboam at the very height of this hill. So I don't know about you as you read that story and as you go through it, but we've got this unnamed Levite, and he's purposely held the name back. You know he's not, this is not accident. He's wanting us to sort of, and then just, you've got to be kidding. Moses? Gershom? Gershom was Moses' oldest son, if you remember, Zipporah. Zipporah was not happy with Moses not circumcising Gershom, if you remember that story in Exodus chapter 2. That's that Gershom. And this is how far religiously the nation that the great, great, great grandson of Moses is leading a cult of his own. So it's kind of, it's different, but it's one of the great figures of Christian faith in early America was Jonathan Edwards. Some think he was the greatest theologian ever born. Do you know who his great-grandson or grandson was? Aaron Burr. And when you think of Aaron Burr, you don't think of Jonathan Edwards in theology. You think of a driven, self-directed man who ended up with duels with all kinds of people and ended up killing Alexander Hamilton in one of their duels, the most unworthy of the early American politicians, so grandson of Jonathan Edwards, sinners in the hands of a mighty, mighty God. Okay, let's see whatever observations, insights that you have. Yes, Condor, since you caught me with Ehud and Jephthah very rightly, and thank you.
Why does it seem that all the Israelite idols, I mean, both the golden calf and this cult are in Dan? I mean, why do they keep putting idols there?
Because Dan was a place where they would be happy with idols and they were comfortable with them. By the way, nobody knows, but in the list in the book of Revelation,
Dan has bought it from it.
Okay, you can give it back to Mr. Carey. There's a list of 12,000 from each of the tribes. Do you remember that? And all of the tribes are named with one exception, and it's the tribe of Dan. And the question is, why is the tribe of Dan omitted? And it's not an impossible answer, because they, as it were guilty of the first great apostasy, large-scale apostasy of any tribe, to set up this idolatrous cult. That's a guess, but I think it's probably a fairly reasonable guess of why Dan was not present in that list. Yes, Elizabeth. Just wait.
Would it be fair to say that presently in our culture we have, in Christendom, we have churches that value icons in a similar way, in that they use that as their intermediate means of praying, means of grace, those kind of things? Is that as serious idolatry?
I think both in Orthodoxy and in Catholicism, you know, with icons and images, they will strongly say those are not idols. They will affirm in the strongest language that they are being used in different ways than that. So that's what they say. I think for the average normal person, you know, the lay person, there's very little doubt that most of them affirm special holiness. I mean, you can go into the Vatican and you can look at certain statues and so forth, and there are places on the Pietà, the Michelangelo's carving, it's now behind glass because somebody tried to destroy it, but where the foot has been kissed bare because so many people came to kiss the foot of that statue.
And I think
it amounts to idolatry, although they insist that it isn't. So.
And even prayer beads. I saw this in United Arab Emirates when we mingled with some of the Muslim women in Dubai on the sand, and they would hold on to that. They couldn't let go. And anytime you're holding on to something that you put such value in, that comes close to being idolatry. as well, wouldn't it be? So it's kind of common now.
Superstition is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
An ever-present temptation.
I think just to build on that point a little bit, you know, it's interesting here, Micah's mother says that I solemnly consecrate this the silver to Yahweh, the Lord. In Exodus, when Aaron helps the Israelites forge the golden calf, they say, you know, this is the Lord your God that brought you up out of the land of Egypt. So it's not that they were nominally worshiping a false god. They were nominally worshiping the true God. But they were worshiping him in a way that he had not prescribed. He had actually strictly forbidden. And that's true here, and it's true in Exodus. So it's also an important point that God is not only to be worshipped, but there's a way that he there's a way that he wants to be worshipped, and he gives that to us. And you can't worship God by other means, whether they be images or, you know, pulling practices from other religions and saying, well, I'm just using this practice to worship Christ or to worship the Lord of the Bible. It's not really, God doesn't really approve of that.
I think that, you know, the idolatry is two things. It is the worship of false gods, and it is the worship of the true God in false ways. And and both of them are idolatrous in that particular way. The Canaanites worship false gods. The Israelites are worshiping the true God in a false way.
Right.
And I think we also need to recognize that our danger in our place now. I was struck, and this is as a tell you more about me perhaps than anything, but I was struck when the Pope was here watching the reactions of people to the Pope and trying to get as close to him as possible with the feeling that that's as close to God as you can come on earth. And he touched me. And I remember John Boehner just weeping. Of course, he cries at almost anything, but that he'd had a private session with the Pope when he was the Speaker of the House. And or you watch, again, our Hispanic friends out of their history of the Lady of Guadalupe, and when they do processions and they and if that's not idolatry, I don't know. It's about as close as you could possibly come to it. And I think any biblical sense says, you don't try to get as close as you come. It's like driving. You don't try to get as close to the edge as you can unless you're stupid. You try and be as far away as you possibly can from what is false. But Luther once said, or maybe it was Calvin, I'm not sure, one of the two, once said that, Calvin said that the human heart is an idol factory. But it was Luther, I think, who said that, and he was more accepting of some of the images. But it isn't simply metal images of God that is idolatry. It is mental images of God that is idolatry. And so when people say, I like to think of God as, what follows is in 9 times out of 10 idolatrous. It is the God they like to think of rather than the God who is there. And that's our form of idolatry, I think, more than any other that we battle with. I like to think of God as, God could never do that. Yeah, but he said he does. So, anyway, Colleen.
This golden calf thing has been really interesting to me for a few years. I don't remember which year it was, in women's Bible study, that we were studying the divided kingdom, Israel, and the history. And I remember preparing for our lesson and reading some study notes on the passage of Jeroboam and his golden calves. And the little historical notes I read said, I mean, this is just what the notes said, that the golden calves weren't the deities in themselves, but that they were generally pictured, they were generally carved by the Canaanites to carry their gods, to be the symbols of their power and their authority. And they were usually pictured with their gods seated on them. But Jeroboam, of course, was doing Yahweh worship, so his golden calves had no visible god because they were worshiping Yahweh. But what struck me was that I realized that in my own life, in my past, that's how I had treated Sabbath, because I had believed it was the mark of true worship, and it was the only way to worship God. So in a sense, the Sabbath for me had carried God, and it was like giving up an idol when I realized that I had to worship him without that day carrying him.
Thank you.
So Women of the Word, as you know, is reading Packer's Knowing God. And we talked about chapter 4 this week. And I was reading out of it today, and there's a section, and I'm not sure if I understood it fully because I was doing multiple things with my kids too. But I'm pretty sure I understood him to say that even going as far as to say, I'd like to think of God as Father more than judge, which he's revealed himself to us as judge, but picking the parts of him that we prefer and kind of putting aside the other parts of him, it was also kind of treated as a mental idol. Did I understand that right?
Well, I don't know exactly what, but yeah, I mean, our responsibility is not to create our view of God, but to sit under the authority of what he's revealed about himself. And to make sure that we have an honest and true picture of God. It's one of my complaints, for example, about, I've got a number of them, but about the Jesus calling kind of books, is that you listen to that and it's all sweet and it's all nice. Jesus sounds very womany, pardon me, but it's a woman writing and it sounds all of that. But that's not the Jesus we meet in the book of Revelation, in the letters to seven churches, and it's not the Jesus of the Gospels, because she's only chosen to say Jesus says these kinds of things. But Jesus is also the one whose eyes have flames of fire and demands holiness and those kind of things. So yet we're always tempted to that, to make God in our own image, mental or metal. Well, I've got enough of my pet peeves off my shelf or chest tonight, so we better pray here to conclude. Father, I know I'm a far more of an idol worshiper than I would like to think of myself, and I don't even see it because I'm often blind to it. Help me to see, know, love, cherish you as you truly are. But I thank you in the midst of it all. You've bid us know you as Father and draw close to you in that way. So thank you for who you are in your love and grace. And even as we look at Israel, to think that you just didn't wipe your hands of them, even in this depth of sin and this utter confusion, you still acted in grace. But help me to remember that your word says, let him who thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. So protect our hearts, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.